Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Stepping Up. I'm your host, Danielle Dubois. This week we do a highlight and reflect on the Ministry of Education's year. And for Link Up, I chat with dancer and creative Shatoya Jean-Baptiste. This year was an interestingly challenging year for the education sector. Parents, students, teachers, and administration all had to adjust to the new normal that COVID-19 has brought on. From classrooms to e-books, from the chalkboard to online learning platforms, this year was unprecedented and saw major growth, flexibility, and innovation from everyone involved. Everyone basically had to step up and do what had to be done to ensure that learning continues, taking into consideration health and safety. As Stepping Up winds down for the year, we wanted to chat with the PS of the Department of Education, Innovation, and Gender Relations, Michelle Charles, to get some more insights on the vision for St. Lucia's education sector and how they continue to adapt and move on with their mandate. We spoke about TVET and opportunities for persons to continue their education, the Sporting Academy, among other initiatives by the Ministry of Education. Let's take a look at the interview. To end our season is Ms. Charles, the PS of the department. Ms. Charles?
Thank you very much, Danielle, for agreeing to feature Ministry of Education on the program, especially now is a good time because though it's the end of the program for you, at least this season, it's a very good time to feature education.
Yes, I think so, because I was just curious. It has been an interesting year, and I don't want to use bad because everybody know the year has been tumultuous. I would allow you, let's reflect on the year. You know, a lot has happened from school closing and opening, trying again, and the closure. So as PS, let's just talk about that.
Well, for this year for us at the Ministry of Education, it has been a year that has shown us our levels of flexibility, agility, and our levels of responsiveness as a ministry. It has also been given us the opportunity where we got to see the best in people. But of course, there are the challenging times. But I'm happy to say that as a ministry, that we're not battling all of this all by ourselves. And we have, I'm surrounded by a team of persons who help us make the best decisions for the Ministry of Education. Trying as the circumstances may be, but we've been managing and I expect it to get better.
What would you say are some of the highlights of the year?
One of the major highlights for us this year was us being able to push forward our ICT agenda.
Yes.
I know we have gotten a lot of bashing as it relates to Ministry of Education and devices and persons not having access. But for us at the ministry, it has been a priority integrating ICT into education, and we were well on the path to doing so. However, with the impact of COVID, this has really pushed us, you know, to get us to do this quicker than we anticipated. And so that was one of the challenges, but it's also a highlight for us because currently we're providing our teachers and students with devices, and this has helped accelerate our ICT into education integration.
Now, I know before COVID that ICT, that education agenda, if ICT and the blended aspect and bring it in within the classrooms for assessment, etc., has been there before COVID. And we know that because of COVID now, it had to basically push you all to do it a lot faster. So since we know that the ICT program has always been a part of education, what would you say is the general vision of education now for St. Lucia? What is it that you guys are looking to achieve in the next year?
For us, we are really about ensuring that first, no child is left behind, and also to be able to graduate citizens who are able to compete globally. And that means providing them with all of the necessary skills and that they would require to be able to compete in this global environment. We know that our world at the moment is very technical. Technology drives things. And ICT integration is a key component for us as it relates to having those featured, those subject areas featured in our curriculum. So we want to ensure that our students are able to graduate with the skills that would allow them to function effectively and be competitive on a global scale.
Nice. We know that recently ebooks were, how many ebooks were distributed island-wide?
That's a major project for us at the Ministry of Education. We initially thought we could have started off with a pilot of 3,000 devices. We said we would have distributed those at 13 of our secondary schools, where those students would have chosen their subjects at the end of Form 2 and would have allowed us to monitor the effectiveness of this system or of this project over a three-year basis. So we rolled out that pilot in February at 13 of our schools. And then come March, there was COVID and students were home. And we realized that many of our students did not have the necessary devices. The students who had gotten The initial set of e-books were privileged in that it allowed them to continue their education online. And the beauty of this is that it already has content aligned to the CSEC syllabus. And so we decided that we were going to go full-fledged now in ensuring that we are able to bridge that gap. So we rolled out the second part of our e-books initiative in September with the same 13 schools, but now we are going to be rolling it out into the other 9 secondary schools on Ireland. So by the end of December, moving into the second term, all of our students, at least from Form 2 to Form 4 within our secondary schools, are going to be provided with e-book devices.
Mm-hmm. And what makes the e-book devices, what makes that program stand out from other programs that were attempted in the past?
In the case of our current project, what I really like about it is that there's the content already aligned to the CSEC syllabus, but it also allows for our students to carry out simulations and labs, especially for the science students. Yeah. Because we know that the labs component of the sciences can be very expensive at the schools because you need to buy all of the chemicals and the various agents required. And if students are able to do that on their own within a virtual setting, it means a child who may not have grasped the concept in class can still go home and do the lab a million times until you figure it and get it right. Mm-hmm. So I like the interactive nature of that device.
Yes, mm-hmm. Nice. So, and we know that COVID-19 has really shined a light on a lot of our inadequacies and our weaknesses as a system. What do you have to say to teachers now who there's a lot of talking about fatigue and, you know, with new problems and new solutions, you have you still have new problems?
Yes, yes. Well, for me, I'm very optimistic. Mm-hmm. And I would like our teachers to see this as an opportunity for them to develop themselves further. There's opportunity in diversity, I always say. And of course, our teachers are very challenged at this time, especially in some cases where they have no devices. Some persons, I like to say, are kind of e-averse in terms of using the electronic media for teaching. But this is an opportunity that that teachers get to embrace and learn for themselves. Mm-hmm. And I must say too that many of our teachers are embracing what we refer to now as the new normal.
Yeah.
Initially, when we started off in March into the third term, there was this hesitation and the learning curve was kind of steep. But now we notice that there is a reduction in the learning curve. It's not as steep as it used to be. That means our teachers are embracing the technology. And I would like to encourage them to do so. Mm-hmm. The ministry is also has provided and will continue to provide a number of training opportunities for our teachers. And I would like them to get on board because this is only going to enhance their skill sets moving forward.
Nice. As you mentioned, training opportunities, what are some of the other exciting things that the ministry is still ensuring to send out and to provide for our citizens?
Ministry of Education, some of our strategic priorities, of course, the first one everybody knows is ICT in education. Mm. But what I have always referred to as sometimes the best kept secret within the ministry is our TVET policy, in terms of how we are going to get the nation, industry, people to recognize that TVET is as equally of importance as other academic areas, to say. And so we're focusing heavily on the components of technical and vocational education and training.
Mm-hmm.
So this is another strategic priority for us at the Ministry of Education. And to that end, we are moving heavily towards increasing our pool of assessors and verifiers within the ministry, or within the community, the society at large, ensuring that we have a number of our CVQs developed so we could allow our secondary school children, they too can graduate not only with CSEC subjects, but also with CVQs. We're in the process of promoting CVQs in a big way,
mm-hmm.
especially to industry and to tertiary level educate institutions.
Mm-hmm.
Because you want a child who would have graduated, say, in plumbing, somebody who has a capacity or a passion for, say, plumbing, electrical, tiling, that you can graduate with some portable qualification, and that you may decide, okay, I have my level 2 or 3 CVQ certificate, that should be able to grant me admittance into the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College. So we are promoting that. And also for our employers, in terms of ensuring that they can recognize and accept a student who has a CVQ qualification, be it level 1, 2, 3, 4, recognize them as being proper qualifications to accept them into the world of work.
The world of work. TVET, and we know you're very big on getting opportunities available for persons. Do you guys have opportunities for persons who probably did not complete secondary school? I know that TVET is something that's accessible. Yes. What about the repeating of secondary school years, like the last Form 4, Form 5? You know, I think a lot of people right now are interested in returning to school, like those who probably dropped out or for whatever reason wasn't able to complete their formal education. What are the other opportunities besides TVET that they can access?
For us, we recognize that there is need to always have interventions for our citizens, our students. Mm-hmm. You mentioned the dropouts. We have an increasing dropout rate that we really want to work on and curb. So for us, we're working closely with CARE.
Okay.
And CARE has a program called the Adolescent Development Program, mm-hmm. and we recently got them to adopt the JLP, which is the Junior Life Program. Mm-hmm. And these provide pathways for other students who would not have been able to maybe successfully navigate through secondary school.
Is that tied into the group of persons who went to Trinidad to get to study?
So we had teachers who were trained in the Junior Life Program mm-hmm. and the Adolescent Development Program. So we have trained the teachers within our school setting. We have also augmented the staff at CARE, mm-hmm. and we have a memorandum of understanding with CARE, which allows us to be able to, you know, divert our students, those who are interested in following that program. The beauty of this thing with CARE is that after these students have started the Junior Life Program, after they have met, you know, the competencies required, these students can now reintegrate into a secondary school, mm-hmm. or they could continue with the CARE program, which allows them to graduate with CVQs at the end of it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there are various pathways for our students that we're looking to, you know, to create the awareness of.
So if they were interested in doing that, I guess they just contact the ministry or what?
Yes, you can liaise with us at the Ministry of Education, or you can go directly to CARE because the facility is there. It's available and it's open to persons.
All right. The Grizzly Sporting Academy. Yes. Let's talk about that.
Of course, that's another baby for us at the Ministry of Education, the St. Lucia Sports Academy. Yeah. You know, initially we were thinking of centers of excellence, and we were looking at two facilities, and we've been able to make much progress with the former Grosley Secondary School, which has now been re-established as the St. Lucia Sports Academy. Mm-hmm. Currently, we have over 100 students in-house. There's been great uptake this year because we had about 42 new students enroll into the program this year. This is new, it's different. It has never happened in St. Lucia where you have students coming to school and living on dorm.
It's almost like a boarding school kind
of
thing.
Yes, so our students are there. It's a combination of both academic and sporting programs that are being offered to the students. Mm-hmm. The feedback from parents and students, very positive. For us, the little glitch in the system has to do with maybe some of our infrastructural works that we were hoping to be completed by now. But we're making some progress, mm-hmm. and I'm expecting that by the end of this school year, the Sports Academy should be well equipped to be able to provide the kind of facility that we expect a Sports Academy to look like. But I can also say with pride that we've been getting a lot of interest from regional.
People are now starting to pick up on it.
Yes, not only local, but a number of regional and international.
And that's an option as well?
Yes, it is, mm-hmm. eventually. Let us just
settle.
Yes, let us just consolidate what we have, make it into a real sound program. And the principal and the team who work at the Sports Academy, they are very competent. I have a good group of guys and girls, ladies, at the academy. And the boys themselves are very excited. I was very excited when school reopened.
So it's only boys now?
We have girls. We initially started last year with only boys, but we have a few girls in the program, and they stay on the
dorm. And when you started, it was like a small number, like 20 or something like that?
Yes, we probably had just about 30 students initially. But that number has grown. That number has grown, and we are focusing on those three sporting components of cricket, athletics, and football.
Wow, a lot of successes for the Ministry of Education this year. And how old are they? Has a year passed as yet?
Yes, they're just a little over a year. Nice. We started in September of 2019. Mm-hmm. Yes, so it's just about that time. I would have, if it wasn't for COVID, then we would have had greater opportunity to really evaluate the program. But so far, it's been very successful. Our students are, they're very happy with where they're at. Even their parents too commend the ministry in terms of developing that pathway for our students, because the real vision of the Sports Academy is to ensure our students have a different pathway. Those who wish to pursue a career in sports, they could become, you know, professional athletes, whether in their field, but also open up other gateways for them. So if you want to become a sports therapist, whatever it is, event manager, in terms of sports, then that avenue is open to you.
And it's clear that the mandate of the ministry is to diversify learning options.
Definitely.
Through ICT, through TVET, through the specific, through sports, etc. So in hopefully by the next year, 2 years, it will really see this momentum start to pick up with the ministry.
But there's so much scope for a lot of things to happen within the Ministry of Education. We have been doing a lot. There's a lot going on. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's why you don't hear all what we're doing, because we're so busy ensuring that we get things out. But there's a lot going on within the Ministry of Education. And we'd be happy to sit with you at any other time to discuss our various initiatives.
Well, Pierce Charles, congratulations on all the work spearheading and being the team lead behind all of this that the ministry has been able to achieve this year and the previous years. Final words from you and anything you'd like to touch on.
Yes, I would definitely want to extend all of the congratulations that you just extended to me, to my team, because by myself, I'm just the administrative head, the accounting officer within the ministry. However, I have some very competent technical persons who I work with, and I really have to extend my gratitude to them for being as supportive, especially in these trying times. While other persons or departments can probably sometimes work from home or be on rotation, my team has been here for the most part just about every day. Yeah. So I really need to thank them. I also want to thank our teachers, our parents and our students, our ancillary staff within our schools for being patient with us. We know it's a difficult time, but the ministry really has the best interests of our stakeholders at heart. And so we're looking, as we move forward, we're all going through this challenge together, that at the end of it, we all come out better for it.
Yeah.
Yes. So thank you for this opportunity, for sharing with St. Lucia too what happens within the Ministry of Education.
Well, I want to say thank you, and we heard it from the lady herself. Thank you very much.
You're most welcome, Daniel.
Tired of battling large numbers of mosquitoes in the comfort of your home? The more you fight, the more defeated you feel. How about taking on a longer-lasting solution? Ensure that drums or buckets are properly covered after each use. Drain and dispose of any unwanted containers to reduce potential breeding grounds for mosquitoes. Do not allow tires to collect water on your property. Fill them with soil to make your own vegetable gardens or plant flowers. Poorly disposed garbage can collect water. Use secure bins when disposing of garbage in order to reduce mosquito breeding. Keep vegetation low to allow daylight in and remove hiding places for mosquitoes and other pests. Check your roof gutters regularly to prevent mosquito breeding. Regularly inspect your property for signs of mosquitoes. Following these tips once a week can reduce the population of mosquitoes in and around your home.
For more information, visit or call the Environmental Health Division in Guadawash Groseley at 468-3700 or 468-3737.
Thank you, Ms. Charles, for sitting down to chat with us. We wish you and the ministry all the best as you guys continue moving forward. Now it's time for Link Up. With more than 10 years' experience in the performing arts industry, Chateau Jean-Baptiste training extends from dance styles such as African, soca, traditional folk, dancehall, contemporary and modern, to educating and directing. She has represented St. Lucia at numerous regional and international cultural dance exchanges and dance exposés. Currently, she's a senior student at Towson University, where she studies theater arts, theater design, and production, with a focus in scenic design. To date, she has designed sets for the university and started Sure 758. Let's take a look at our Link Up interview. How are you, Chatoya? And thank you so much for agreeing to do this interview.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm doing all right. And how has COVID-19 touched you this year? I know it's you know, as a creative, it hasn't been easy, but how are things?
It hasn't been easy. My classes are all on standby. School is online, which is kind of a good thing. I'm in St. Lucia, which is also a good thing. But I'm not creating as much as I want to.
Yeah.
But I mean, it has the good and the bad.
Yeah.
Nice. So just give our St. Lucian audience, you know, give us a little background on you. We know that you're studying overseas. Let us know what exactly you're studying, and we're going to take it back from there.
Okay, no problem. So I moved to the States like probably 3 years ago, and I started my bachelor's in theater arts. When you get into like your last 2 years, you have to select your major, and there was acting, dance, stage management, lighting design, and scenic design. So I selected scenic design, and the reason being is my mom is a decorator, so I've always been around like I wasn't raised normally, like in my house.
You had a rich life experience that, you know, molded you into this type of field.
Okay. Yes, my mom will match the curtains with the cushions and the rug. Like, my mom wasn't simple. So growing up in that atmosphere of always like being handsy, being into craft, mm-hmm. it was easy for me to go into scenic design. So scenic design is basically like the architect of what the architect is to reality is what scenic design is to theater. So basically, we design and create the space that the play is going into, or the dance production has to be in. So it's everything except the props and the actors.
Right.
Nice. And you chose a very interesting field, because we know in St. Lucia, we now have I would like to say that our theater field is now starting to reemerge. And, you know, COVID-19, it wasn't really a good year for all the artists. But I'm sure, you know, as a stage designer, it's not only for theater, it's for events, it's for concerts, it's everything.
It's for film, everything.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So let us know a little bit about Sher758. You know, you have your BAM. I don't know if the audience know, but you're an avid member. You were an avid member of Silver Shadows, and now you've actually created your own thing. So let's talk about Sher758.
All right, no problem. So Sher actually began, I don't want to say accidentally, but where I am now was not where I thought I'd be when I started, which is a good thing. Sher emerged from the fact that when I went to the States, I had no avenue for dance. I had no place that I could go to express myself. So I had to create my own. And with that, I started dance classes, Caribbean dance classes in Baltimore. Daniel, yeah, people don't know about soca. Like, I had so much.
Were you charging for your classes? Nice.
Yeah.
Mm. And I'm sure it was oversold up eventually.
My God.
That's what I mean.
I only had two classes. Where I had people out of like 15 classes. Majority of my classes were empty. So instead of like saying, okay, I'll go home since there's no one at class, no, I took that time to practice on myself. So that's where Sher actually emerged. So right now, Sher is a choreographer, scenic designer, and dancer. Yeah. So Sher is me, and I live and breathe the arts.
Yeah, and I think it's nice that you say Sher is you, because sometimes we like to compartmentalize the things that you can do as an artist. But then I think it's nice when you start to brand yourself and you're able to offer all of these different services. It really helps you grow, and it really gets people to start to see and understand what the work of a creative artist is. So we know that when you came down, your classes were packed in St. Lucia, though. You understand? So let's know about that.
My first set of classes, I was really nervous to do it, because you know, like when you come up with a new idea in St. Lucia, people are like, who that girl think she is? Why that girl want to do that? All kind of questions. So yeah. I questioned myself a lot, but I said, you know what? I'll just bite the bullet and I'll go ahead. Yeah. So I went ahead. I had my first class. My first class was free. And then I started charging after that. And after the Budum class, like it just grew, it just took away. Like Sher is bigger than myself, as much as I am Sher. It stands for a lot more than I even could imagine.
Yeah. Yeah. And I know that Sher, you continue to be a champion for Denry segments, and you carry it with you everywhere you go. And, you know, it was nice seeing that growth and development from doing your classes and getting the hype from the Budum. And then, you know what, in, like, you started to realize yourself as this ambassador to music and dance and a St. Lucian icon. So how was it? What was probably your most memorable moment or memory of, you know, letting people who've never heard the Denry segment before actually experience the music?
Wow, that's a really tough one. Wow. I would say the most memorable was Budum by Kuya. And the reason I'd say that is I created that choreography, I don't want to say very simply, but it just came really natural as compared to my other choreographies. And I just never expected it to blow like that. And the way everyone just took it and everyone was having fun, like me seeing my movement on people and the way that they just have fun with it is what I love. So in that moment when it was recognized and people were sharing it and it got so many views, I was like, wow, I'm doing the right thing. Like, I'm on the right path. Like, yeah, it was like a validation for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's really interesting to know. So sure, just as we wrap up, what message do you have for St. Lucians? You know, and if they didn't know you, have you the owner, managing director of Show 758, you also decorate spaces, you choreograph pieces for anybody who wants to have a creative piece with dance. Let them know what that experience is like, and what advice do you have for anyone who might want to, I call these things creative vibes, you know? Because it's not, you know, so let us know.
So my experience as a creative, there's so much to say on it, but I'm going to be very short. It has changed my life. Mm-hmm. Theater and dance have changed me and molded me into the individual that I am. And there are so many benefits of it. And to the public, I want to say, let me change that to the parents of individuals who are artists. I'll be very specific. Allow them to grow. Allow them to create. There are so many times I see students who say, I want to study acting. I want to do this, but my parents.
Yeah.
Parents, allow these creatives to grow, because what the parents are doing, they're quieting the next generation of creatives. Yeah. And if you look at St. Lucia, we are based on arts and culture. Like, just let them grow. Give them a chance. Listen to them. Encourage them.
Yeah. And that's an important point, sure. And I haven't thought about that in a while. And that's something that really used to irk me, especially when I used to teach theater arts. Like, you would see just the, I don't want to say ignorance, but just the averse thinking towards, oh my God, theater arts, what's that, you know? And why, you know? And a lot of people, but I hope, like, you know, people like you and, you know, people like me in different spheres as well are the ambassadors to groom that next generation of actors and dancers and creatives. And I know that's probably part of your plan, because you've brought in so many people into the fray with your videography, with your designs, and even had a clothing line as well with the same show, 758. So,
yeah, I mean, and another point I would say to the artists this time is, I know what we are doing, a lot of people see it as strange. A lot of people see it as, like, if someone asks you, what are you, what's your job? And you say, I'm an artist, they'll be like, oh, what's your backup plan? Like, we need to normalize that it's okay to be an artist. And yeah. I'm not going to say creating the clothing line, collaborating with different dancers and videographers is easy, but it has made me grow into the person that I am. Yeah. And it has made, I learned from each video, and each video after has been better than the first. So just keep growing as an artist. Yeah. That's what I would say.
And as you continue your work, Shatoya, I want to say keep stepping up. I know that you still try to do little things in terms of bringing out different themes. I saw your video and trying to highlight depression and mental illness, you know, and that form of artistic expression using the form of dance. So just continue doing what you're doing, yeah? So I don't know if you have anything else to say, but, you know, I think we've come to the end of our little interview, Shatoya.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. This was fun. enjoyed it.
All right, thank you, honey.
Welcome. Bye.
Looks like we are at the end of our show for now and for the season. I want to thank you so much for joining us as we followed so many stories and journeys of St. Lucians here and abroad, doing amazing things, flying our flag high, making us proud, and surely inspiring someone. I'm your host, Daniel Dubois. Season's greetings and all the best for the new year. See you soon. Be safe and don't forget to keep stepping up.